will come to order. This is the April 23rd, 2019 meeting of the Citizens Police Review Board. Members we have present are Mr. Williams, Sister Patrice, Dr. Brescio, Ms. McClellan, Ms. Waters, and Mr. Green is excused for tonight. Okay. I hope all of you have had a chance to read the minutes of the March meeting. Are there any corrections or additions? If not, may I have a motion to accept the minutes of the March 26th meeting?
I shall move.
Second. It's been moved and properly seconded. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. The motion carries. I would like to just commend Ms. Pittinger and the staff of the board for the news conference they held recently. The publicity was very nice. The coverage on TV was exceptional, as well as the newspaper coverage, and I'm sure she's going to tell us more about that. The pamphlet itself is quite comprehensive, and I'm sure it's going to do a lot of good in our community. So if there are opportunities we have to distribute them, we can help her. I carry several in my purse all the time now so that I can hand them out when appropriate. But it's really a useful pamphlet to have, and they're to be commended. All of the individuals who have contributed to it, the organizations that contributed to it, and Ms. Pettigrew and Mrs. Stevens in particular, for making that pamphlet as comprehensive as it is. So we will wait for additional comments from Ms. Pettigrew when she gives her report. Okay. At this time, Ms. Pettigrew, you can give your report.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good evening, members. First matter is that we have some terms that are expiring October 31st of 2019. Those seats, Mr. Waters, Mr. Green, Dr. Lucas Garvey, and Mr. Williams. We are required to give notice to the City Council and to the Mayor, as they are appointing authorities. Mr. Waters and Mr. Green are both nominated by City Council, and Dr. Darby and Mr. Williams are mayoral appointees, and Mr. Williams is a law enforcement professional appointee. That notice that will be delivered to those parties June 1st, and we're required under the City Code to give notice of 180 days to the public. And those notices will be running. The latest one is May 3rd. They have to be publicized by no later than May 4th. So those will all be in the paper and distributed widely. But I have certainly let the appointing authorities know that you are eligible, able, and willing to continue in your position as a member of the Independent Citizen Police Review Board. Now, the You and the Police brochure that Dr. Darby mentioned, the new version is being eaten up by the public. We've published 20,000 of them, and we're down to 7,300 left of that 20,000. And they're going to use. They're not going to somebody's garage and sitting or in the trunk of a car. The press conference that Dr. Darby mentioned on April the 9th was a collective of individuals. It was community, and there were police. The police leadership that was there included Chief Schubert and Chief of Staff Commander Holmes and Sergeant Eric Baker of the Pittsburgh Bureau of Police, Sheriff Mullen, Port Authority Lieutenant Hudzinski, the Chief of the Pittsburgh Public Schools Police, Chief Brown, We had Mr. Stewart, who's usually with us tonight, but not this evening, the president of the NAACP Pittsburgh Unit, Urban League Board Member Reverend Grayson, the Pittsburgh Interfaith Impact Network Chairperson of the Public Safety Committee, Carol Valance, the President of the Pittsburgh Federation of Teachers, Nina Esposito-Viscaitis, and the Vice President of the PFT, Billy Hyland. Allegheny County Police Superintendent McDonough and Urban League President Esther Bush were unable to be there, but they did provide letters of support to the project, and those are attached to the Executive Director's report, which was sent electronically late this afternoon. But those, as well as the statement and the outline of the event presented by Mr. Stevens, is included in my report. What was really, there were two major points to this. One, Sheriff Mullen, who announced that he had distributed a copy of You and the Police to all of his deputies, all of his personnel, and he made the public recommendation that we approach the Municipal Police Officers Education Training Commission to include the material in You and the Police in the annual training of police officers across the Commonwealth. That was a very good recommendation, and we'll follow up with that. And the second important, and probably surprising announcement, was from the Department of Bureau of Police Pittsburgh, the Port Authority Police, County Police. They have all agreed that they will distribute You and the Police to their officers and will quiz the officers following their review of that You and the Police brochure. And the reason for that is that in that document, we're given a lot of advice to civilians to behave in a certain way, to try to keep everybody safe, to avoid stranger danger, so that there's not an unexpected action taken by one or the other that they don't expect. So by the officers being familiar, because they certainly know, they know that the technical law enforcement side of what they're doing, certainly. But we wanted to be sure they knew what to expect if a civilian reacted in a certain way, why they were reacting that way. Like, if you pull somebody over and they ask you, may I turn the car off? Well, that's like unusual maybe for somebody to ask that, but we were saying, you know, that might be a way for you to send a signal that you're not going to run. Some officers don't want them to turn the vehicle off, some do. So we just want to be sure that the officers have an awareness of what we're advising civilians to do, or anybody who's pulled over or stopped while on the street, or if an officer comes to their house, or if they're taken into custody, whatever it may be. So that was a pretty significant event, and those commitments are, it's pretty amazing. To have the police departments commit to that with the community group collaborative speaks a lot to the evolution of the relationship between the community and the police. Sister Patrice Hughes was there as a representative of the board, and it was wonderful to have you there, Sister.
Thank you. And let me say, after the associate superintendent for the Pittsburgh Public Schools spoke about how they were working that in the high schools with the social studies teacher, and so I got up and said that I thought I could speak for the diocese in high schools, because I work very closely with them, that we would be able to make the same arrangements. And the interesting thing, I wasn't authorized to do that, but when I went back the next day, here I discovered there's a principal's meeting occurring on May the 3rd, and I said, I'd like to be on the agenda, but first I'd better talk to the superintendent. He said, oh, I think that's a great idea. And Beth has agreed to be here. And all of our high schools will be present and see what they see as the best way of proceeding with this. But I think I'm really happy. And I have read the brochure a few times, so I'll take the test.
Okay, we have to write it for our sister, and maybe you don't do that. That's a remarkable opportunity that presents itself, Sister. I'm really delighted to come to that meeting. Thank you for inviting me. And we'll get this distributed to those schools as well, and, you know, broaden the exposure so that hopefully we can keep people safe. That's the whole point here, is to just keep people safe. And to follow up on that, there was yet another press conference on April the 15th. Again, it was sponsored by BPEP, and it was to promote a number of proposals that BPEP and on many of the proposals CPRB had collaborated. But Mr. Stevens wanted to put out his big agenda for all of the various ideas and police accountability ideas that BPEP is promoting, but they also have community partners, and we are a major partner with that group. The Due Process Act, you may remember that. That is the bill or the proposal that we made that was intended to relieve the actual or the perceived conflict of interest between local district attorneys and local police officers when there's an incident resulting in the death of an armed or unarmed person at the hands of police pursuant to the use of force by a police officer. We also included correctional officers, and I think I spoke about this in our last meeting, but that's a major proposal that's being considered in the legislature in a variety of different forms. It's a proposal to amend the Commonwealth Attorneys Act, and there are a lot of details to trying to do that. But you got to start somewhere, and if we can come into some kind of an agreement or something in the middle that everybody can agree to, then perhaps we will make a difference in that perceived conflict of interest, and that those instances that result in the death of someone won't be as suspicious when it comes to the prosecution side or the non-prosecution side. You might recall that District Attorney Cipolla did write a letter supporting our proposal, provided that both investigation and prosecution were in the hands of that special prosecutor, that independent source, whomever it may be. So that's a positive support that we did receive that hasn't changed, although I do know that there are some legislators in different parts of the state with different variations on that theme of amending the Commonwealth Attorneys Act to accomplish something similar to what we proposed. We'll keep you up to date on that. April 16th, I believe it was, a number of us attended a session that was sponsored by the Allegheny County Bar Association, their civil rights litigation section. It was on contemporary court rulings and their influence on police and municipal conduct, related to police conduct. Dr. Darty was there, Mr. Waters was there, Ms. Thorman, Ms. Gamble, and myself, and Mr. Ward. We all attended that session. And the technical side of it, does have meaning and application in the work that we do on their behalf, because we have to know what's the guidance. You know, we get into this discussion about police officer use of force, and everybody's got an opinion about it, but they shouldn't have done this, they shouldn't have done that. You have to know what the basis and the standard against which their conduct's going to be measured. And while we can have a populist opinion about it, the decision on what's going to control the ultimate analysis of a police officer's conduct in a critical situation is going to be the precedents established by courts. A good example of that is the reasonable person standard versus the reasonable officer standard. There's a difference. And an officer's conduct is not going to be evaluated from a reasonable person's perspective, what we think. It's going to be evaluated from a reasonable officer's perspective, a person who is similarly situated, similarly trained, similarly experienced as a police officer. And those are the nuances and the reality of the system that we work in that is contrary to populist opinions and perspectives and expressed thoughts about how something should be or shouldn't be. And I think that the Antoine Rose verdict was a good example of how it's difficult to understand outcomes if you don't understand what goes into that. And, you know, there's some suggestion that perhaps it wasn't vigorously prosecuted. Who knows? We know what the jury said. But we also know that the standards that apply are not what populist perception of standards to be applied are. So I thought it was a really good session. And it also, you know, the role of the municipality, when you listen to how many times we've paid to settle lawsuits and such, where you can see deficiencies in the process and the checks and balances with the system. Why are we continuing to pay out for certain officers time after time after time? So it was a good session. And I appreciate Mr. Ward giving us a heads up that it was going to be presented. The citywide public safety council meeting was last week. You might recall Mr. Waters had suggested that we go out to the public safety councils and give some information on what we do, what our role and function is in city government. So we started to do that in March. We went to Zone 3's public safety meeting. There's a gap now because they have their citywide a couple times a year, and then there's no council meeting until you go back to the summer. So we have a couple scheduled through the summer. But the citywide event was last Wednesday. It was at the Teamster Temple. And it was a program presented by an FBI intelligence analyst. And it was entitled Recognizing and Reporting Hate Groups and Extremism in Your Neighborhood. And it was a good, you know, informative session, giving some advice, some things to look out for, explaining how social media and hacking and then subtle hard signs around in the neighborhood could alert you that there is something something predominantly focused on white supremacy, but that there might be some of that activity going on. And they explained how to recognize it. It was a good meeting. It was a very good meeting. A great bunch of people, a couple hundred people there. And we were able to distribute you and the police to all of them. And a couple of zones took a number back so they could distribute at their neighborhood events. And that is, I believe, all I have for you. If you have questions, I'm happy to answer them.
I have one. So celebrating you and the police and the pamphlet, celebrating that. Getting the information out there. And that whole initiative so that the getting the information out will make better interactions between citizens and police. And you mentioned the thing about safety. And somewhat the goal is that it should present some element of safety so people know how to interact. My question is there other thoughts or initiatives to build upon that? And I'll personally speak on something that I've been disturbed at because of the incident with the Antoine Rose situation, where I'm just personally disturbed is that in one incident, Antoine Rose's comments probably weren't captured, but his behavior spoke to the same thing. In the same scenario, on two sides of the fence, you had two people who feared for their safety. And so the outcome being different from one versus the other. And so, not criticizing or judging because it's been litigated. I'm just saying, in one incident, you had an officer who says he acted because he had fear of his safety. And we had behaviors of a citizen who acted in a certain way, and certainly it could be thought that he had fear of his safety. Well, in the same incident, two different perspectives and the outcomes are different. So, I think there has to be some continuation about when we talk about safety that. The pamphlet is all well and good, but I think that needs to be a continuation on how we continue not only to talk and discuss but and inform, but how we interrelate so that we can minimize incidents that would be so highly publicized and criticized or, you know, assessed in different ways. So that's my statement.
Yes, I agree with you. There has to be some follow-up, there has to be some meat put into the whole effort. We're hopeful that we'll be able to go back to Pittsburgh Public Schools through their social studies department, middle schools and high schools, we've done that before, to try to engage with the students to better understand their view, but also to explain why what we're recommending in this thing is so very important. Also, I conferred with Chief Cole to enhance the civilian understanding of how and why police do what they do. And that kind of goes in tandem with this thing, except this is addressing mostly personal safety and acts that contribute to personal safety. But to do something that is a little bit more geared towards the impression and the attitude towards police and how that can escalate things. I don't know, I mean, if there's something that you think we could do, I'd be happy to pursue it. Mr. Williams, I'm not sure, you know, other than trying to get into the education system and to get back to some sense of, you know, you have to respect things. And the absence of respect, I think, has contributed significantly to the lack of safety and the varied perceptions of circumstances that are actually motivated by the same instinct and a result, as you described, in two very different outcomes. You know, some people blame it on police training. Now, you know that there's a package, in fact, and I believe the Post-Gazette is going to publish an article tomorrow about some of the proposals that the Black Caucus has brought up in the State House. And some of that, one of the big ones is related to looking back at Section 508 of the code that authorizes police use of force and under what circumstances they're permitted to use force, and they want to tinker with that. We've been honest in our reaction to that discussion to try to temper it, to say, look, we don't want any more dead civilians, but we also can't expect an officer to commit suicide before they use force because they're afraid they're going to have to prove something. And there's too much, then, well, you know, you've got a whole other set of circumstances there. So tempering that discussion, I think maybe that's one of the proposals, and maybe it'll go into some public discussion. I don't know. I don't know what the caucus is thinking of doing with these proposals. I know that we did have an opportunity in the summer to speak to the Joint House and Senate Democratic Policy Committee when they held a public hearing on police accountability and police education issues. Senator Costa, his staff has visited with us on two occasions since then. And we've had some pretty interesting discussion about what could be done legislatively, but what else can we do? I don't know.
Yeah, and Mark, I was trying to get a sense of what you know, because you're well connected in a lot of things that are happening, but I think and I want to know if it's something that this board even in recommending or maybe fashioning, but I think that those incidents, especially with use of force and these interactions, a lot of our complaints, even when they come here, are a matter of discourtesy, more than it is use of force. But that's the starting points of this escalation that you talk about with respect. It starts there, and then some people, whether the actions of the officer feel more of a contempt for police officer versus violation of law, but there's an escalation. But then it gets into these buckets that because of my safety and what we've been permitted by law to be able to articulate based on perceptions of threats, and it's very, very, it's very broad, and the public gives police officers a lot of latitude when it comes to that, and I'm not disagreeing, but in with that, I'm not talking about changing that. What I'm talking about is dealing down with what is an actual threat of safety, and that's that reasonable officer standard you're mentioning, that it's hard to articulate against a perception of an officer when they saw that at that time, and that 2020 hindsight cannot come into play. So what we have to do forward is this thing about what's causing the concerns for safety and start whittling at those things before we get to the points of escalation and those actions are happening. So,
and I think that the Pittsburgh Bureau of Police, believe it or not, has really come a long way to be a leader in the promotion of the interaction and the engagement with the community between police and civilians. They really have come a long way. The rude and discourteous conduct complaints that we used to get, we still get them, but not nearly as many. They also completed that 5 years with the National Initiative of Trust and Justice. And what that led to, as some of you are probably familiar, are the events like with targeting youth, where the police are doing specific events, they're defined, there's a purpose, and they do them on a regular basis. There's a spontaneous interaction with the communities. There's a more of a dialogue, a kind of a more relaxed, know me before you have to know me, kind of an approach to the engagements that we've seen. But I think a whole lot of this comes back to civilian conduct and civilian behavior. I shared a story with Dr. Darby about the citywide that I was at last week. The topic was about indoctrination and hate crimes. And there was a woman there who was, she uses a motorized wheelchair. And it was difficult for her to get into Teamster Temple. And I could not find an accessible, I don't know how she got in. There were two individuals using motorized chairs. I don't know how they got in there. But anyway, she was offended and I think felt disrespected because she could not just independently get herself into where she wanted to go. The theme, indoctrination and hate crimes and that sort of thing, she asked a question. And she said, how can you expect me to go and report my fear and concern about hate or white supremacy, to report that to a hate group? The analyst said, I don't think I understand the question. She repeated it pretty much verbatim. And then a third time, likened police to an organized hate group. I think that the irony there was that she was expressing the very hate language and hate talk and indoctrination that we were there to learn about. It was ironic to me. I did defend and said no. No. One thing that the Pittsburgh Bureau of Police is not is a hate group. And her total belief that police were, she likened them to the Klan. She was giving the rhetoric that has been so common around here related to demonstrations pursuant to the outcome of Antoine Rose's trial, verdict for former Officer Rostov. I don't know how we penetrate that. I don't know how we can have any certainty or confidence that we're addressing it to the level that is going to actually make a difference. I mean, I don't know how we measure that, but I think we have to keep talking about it. And I think we're always going to have an element of our community that will never be satisfying or trusting of police officers. And we just have to accept that and live with that. But we can continue to try, and that's what we do. That's why I think certainly the most, Pittsburgh Bureau of Police also has a student police academy, and they have their adult citizen police academy. We have an opportunity to go to those and, talk about contemporary issues. There's a youth group that Commander Lando has. They're meeting twice in May. I don't remember the formal title of it, but it's an organized engagement with police and young people. They're trying to reach out to folks to try to restore some trust. I don't know what else we can do.
Thank you for entertaining my statements.
I'm going to meet with Cookie, or with Chief Coleman tomorrow, and we'll see if she has any ideas, because she usually has a good perspective on community police relationships. With a little bias towards treating people with respect.
I can appreciate the exchange that has just taken place because the community has been hit hard with a lot of things that have happened lately. And the verdict certainly deepens the wounds in this community. But then the next week or so, we'll see a situation where a white young man and a gun, he put it down, picked it up. They shot him in the leg. goes to the hospital, he lives. When blacks are in those situations, they get shot and they die. It's troubling.
And I think that's the common denominator. We keep coming back to, why are so many African Americans dying in the hands of police? And that's the only source of comfort for that, I believe, is to go back to the facts of each incident. And still, oftentimes, end up saying, well, why did this person die? But we have to, you know, facts matter too. Whether they're white or black or whatever the racial identity may be, it still keeps coming back to, why are so many African Americans dead as a result of a police encounter?
Are the pamphlets being distributed to the Propel schools?
Oh, we can do that.
Because they have a population that I think could benefit from that information.
Well, we'll reach out to them. And if anybody knows of anybody interested in contributing towards the publication of the next 10,000 brochures, have them call. You have been very generous in underwriting the two printings.
I'd like to add a few comments here if I can. While I think it is part of our mission to make sure that all sides are treated fairly in a discussion, and I think there's great reason to point out the progress that the Pittsburgh police have made around community police relations, I don't want that acknowledgement to stand in the way of the very stark and brutal realities that we see and the degree, the large Grand Canyon-like crevices in what we see as injustice. And while Antoine Rose brings this to the forefront in terms of the lack of cooperation between the police and African-American communities, the same feelings exist within the LGBTQ community in a very real way. There are members of that community who would say, very much like the woman at the meeting, that the police are acting way outside what a common person may perceive. And for me, what that says is we have so much work to do that communities that are under siege, that are constantly under attack, that are so often disregarded, dismissed, not listened to, and it doesn't fail me that I'm sitting here as a white man saying this. Many others have raised their voices about the injustices, and as a culture, we're not paying enough attention. And so I really want to acknowledge the progress that has been made, but we can't let that stand in the way of giving voice to just how big the crisis is. I was devastated by the verdict. As many people were. And I could also understand how the jury could arrive at it, given the definition of what the police was allowed to do. But one has to wonder, what is wrong in our culture when what the police is allowed to do towards a person who is running away unarmed? There has to be legislative change, there has to be cultural change, and that cultural change can only come through more dialogue. And I'll shut up because I...
Well, much appreciated, Mr. Waters. The disparity is very real. Mm-hmm.
I think we're seeing in another group's voice their concern for making change and are gathering in even small groups to talk about what we can do. And I'll just give one example. The men at my church got together to play chess. They didn't move one chess man, not one. The whole discussion was about what's happening in our society. What can we do? So it is really affecting people in a number of ways, and they are seeking ways to try and change laws that say it's okay for certain actions to be taken away. It's just disturbing, but at the same time, I'm glad to see people talking more and trying to figure out how they can address public policy in a way that's more balanced in what is existing.
Dr. Garvey, was that part of the chess club that the police officer created?
No,
no,
it was in my church.
Okay, it was the church. Yeah, because there is an officer out of Zone 4 who created a chess club and goes around the different zones and has the kids learning to play chess. Yeah, it's... I'm not denying or minimizing. I recognize the huge disparity. I also think that while we address police conduct, we have to address civilian conduct.
Absolutely.
And I think that's Mr. Williams, you're on that. That how do we, like, we can work as we've been working on the one side of that relationship, but we kind of let the other side fall apart. And I say that because of all the stuff that's happened to education, the rigors of education, the topics. I mean, civics, come on. If you don't know how your government is established and organized, then how do you develop any sense of participation and that there is a place for you and that why we have rules and why we have laws and all that sort of thing? Like, why do we need police? Well, we need police because we have to protect order, because, you know, to avoid the chaos that comes from an uninformed or a completely disconnected populace. That part of it, we need to do a better job. And I think if you listen to the educators and the teachers, they're telling us that. They've been telling us that for years. But the policymakers aren't listening. And, you know, here we are, here's the product of it. We can just keep trying and try new things as maybe they come along. Yeah, I think the police are moving towards a lot more technology to try to move towards maybe less engagement, and try to distance themselves. So that, I don't know. I have concerns about that. I have concerns about, you know, database policing, and who knows what the answers are. We're very sick right now. We need to address all the different symptoms. We'll do if we find something we could do. I think that your engagement with the idea of embedding social workers is extraordinarily important.
Yeah.
You know, I said at the last meeting, if we don't scaffold the support around police, they're not competent in anything but what they've been trained in. And having access, there's one social worker, I understand,
right,
on the job here.
Right.
And
Chief Schubert came to the meeting, and he's very supportive of that. So we're going to continue with it.
That will be a huge, important contribution to just the security and confidence of the officers. The other thing, and maybe you saw it on Facebook, I did a little informal poll on whether or not police officers should have more than a high school education. Because I heard a rumor that City of Pittsburgh is attempting to eliminate even the mere 60 college credit requirement because of the disparate impact on non-whites and women. Remember when you had 20 years ago? Yeah, we had it 20 years ago. You wrote a report about it 20 years ago. I find that to be racist, frankly, to say that we have to lower our entry standards because we cannot attract enough non-whites and females to the job. Says a whole lot more about the motivation than anything else. I don't know if there's a formal effort to do that. They did change to where you had to have the 60 credits before you entered the academy. It used to be you had to have the 60 credits at application time. But I think we all recognize it's a curse when you have moved out into the world, perhaps gone through the, Dr. Gershier likes to say, the rigors of education, and develop the self-discipline and the analytical skills, the critical thinking, all of those things, the socialization that you wouldn't otherwise have, and just that intellectual and social-emotional acuity that you can develop through higher education and, frankly, even military. I mean, the military was the issue 20 years ago. They're still given veterans credit, so they move to the top of the list. You know, we get all of that, and the last time we criticized that, I got myself into a lot of trouble. But even with that, there's going to be more exposure to people different than yourself. You're going to have a more rigorous, if you look at the structured training of the Pennsylvania State Police, they're very militaristic. I mean, they break people down to nothing, just like if they were going into the Marines or something, and then rebuild them. And they come out professional, they come out however they come out. But there's a different stature to those officers than there is in most municipal police departments, and maybe that's part of it. I don't know. But the use of force, I think research has reflected that those with a higher education use force less frequently. They tend to try to solve a problem before they resort to force, you know, the old brain versus brawn issue. As I said, I don't know officially if they're moving to eliminate those 60 credits, but I certainly hope they don't. And if they do want to move ahead with it, I hope there's an opportunity for public discussion on it. And as harsh as it sounds, I think to say somebody could have 4 years of flipping a burger somewhere and that qualifies as appropriate experience to become a police officer, I have a problem with that.
Equally, I have a problem with changing the standard because you think people aren't qualified based off of that. That's to your statement. But it was my personal experience working closely with civil service, going out to do recruiting. The vast majority of the people I had contact with were just hundreds, if not thousands, as I went around with this team from this building, that African Americans women did not buy this to be a career choice for them for reasons. It wasn't that they weren't qualified, they just like, I don't want to be a police officer.
Yes.
And that was more of the issue for it. And I think it leads back to their perception about what policing actually is.
Yeah. You have to make this an attractive place where people want to come to work. You know, you got to improve the morale to the point where it's infectious. This is a great place. I want to do this. I want to work in my neighborhood or neighborhoods. I want to be with people. I want to help people. All that, you know, all those, the reasons that the two of you became police officers. I mean, frankly, the absence of the compassion or the interest in the neighborhoods and the people in general, you can't, that's not going to improve your morale, and it's not going to make it an attractive workplace. The report that you guys issued almost 20 years ago, well, okay, 18 years ago, that's exactly what we found, that there were reasons that females chose other careers. And some of it was equipment related, since it's been corrected, but simple things, like just the holster placement was a problem, and they didn't want to be bothered, or the use of lead on the range. They didn't want to be around the lead. Some of them were pregnant, and there was no exception for the maternity side of this job and all those kinds of things. And the other thing we found was that when somebody went on to their 60 credits, they were more likely to go ahead to a four-year degree, and then they were going into federal career law enforcement. They weren't hanging around for municipal law enforcement. And I think a lot of that is related to the minimal qualifications. That your perception as being a professional, there has to be some status to that. There has to be some respect. There has to be some recognition that you are operating on a common body of knowledge, that you're going to make decisions using your discretion, that you're going to make a decision here just like you would make it in Scranton or in Williamsport. That professional part of a police officer is important and it's respected. And this is a great place where you'd want to practice that. I don't know. One of the other proposals that they have down there is moving what is now police officer certification over to the department, Police Department State Bureau of Occupational and Professional Affairs, so that those, that police would be licensed. And it would be under the auspices of Bureau of Professional Occupational Affairs, as opposed to the closed system of the MPOETC, which is administered by the State Police Commissioner. It's completely police. It's closed. The Bureau of Occupational Professional Affairs license is something like 25 or 27 professions in the Commonwealth. They have their standards. They have an investigative unit. They can do backgrounds, can investigate complaints against individuals. You know, it could go against their licensing eligibility. It would move it into a true professional venue for achieving the status of being a professional. I mean, either we want that or we don't. We have to make that decision as a community. But it seems as though we've been pushing and pushing and pushing to go to respect law enforcement as a profession. They have all those little characteristics of a profession. So let's professionalize them and call them what we expect them to be. They'll rise to that. But we have to, you know, we can't have this wishy-washy back and forth. And that's one of the issues, I think, with this kind of behind-the-scenes rumor stuff that I've been hearing about the 60 college credits.
The general populace is becoming more educated. How can they even remotely think that it would be a good idea to lower the standards of the people that have to police them? You know, whenever I came through the academy, it was a high school degree that you had to have, or a high or GED.
Yeah.
And one of the recruits that were in the academy with me couldn't read. And we all know the heartbreaking stories of the children that just get pushed through the system because nobody wants to take the time, or nobody has the time, or parents aren't involved, or whatever it happens to be, that they graduate high school and they're virtually illiterate. You're going back to that if you eliminate a secondary education. I don't care how long, whether they require, you know, 60 credits or 4 years or whatever they require, at least you know they can read. Or I hope they can by that point anyway.
And some of the criticisms I've heard of requiring the 60 credits is that the people with the degrees are the dumbest on the job. You know, a little resentment and a little bit of other stuff there, but I think it's a policy matter. You're right. And I hope that the idea comes out to the public for public discussion so that the board can weigh in on that, if indeed they go in that direction, if we haven't dissuaded them tonight.
Are there other comments? Thank you, Ms. Vivian.
Thank you.
We will move on. Is there any unfinished business? New business? If not, we will turn to the case reviews that have been recommended to us by the investigators and the agenda review items that we received in the package that was sent to us is missing one case. So we need to add one case to full investigation. So we will take the case reviews that we received in the email. We have no public hearings. We have three now for full investigation. The two that were in the package, plus the one that was sent to us, that was given to us tonight. So that's case 05319, 05419, and 0419. You added already.
It was just not emailed to you guys.
Okay, all that's right. Okay.
Sorry
about that. Okay, so it is two cases.
Yes.
Okay, so it's 05319 and 05419.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
May I have a motion to accept the two for full investigation?
Second?
I'll second.
Any questions? All in favor, aye?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it, the motion carries. Okay, we have three for 30-day extensions. We have 10-19, 15-19, and 36-19. May I have a motion to accept the three for 30-day extensions?
Submitted.
Second?
I'll second.
It has been moved and properly seconded. All in favor, aye?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it, the motion carries. We have two that are unsustainable, 2019 and 3319, and we will dismiss these as being unsustainable. May I have a motion, please?
Absolutely.
Second?
Second.
It has been moved and properly seconded. All in favor, aye?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it, the motion carries. We have no that are unfounded. We have three that are suspended, and you can see the reasons why they are suspended until the May meeting. They are cases 419, 1619, and 2919. May I have a motion to move those to the May meeting?
I'll make the motion.
Second?
Second.
It has been moved and properly seconded. All in favor, aye?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it, the motion carries. Okay, we have two others, and I'll take these separately because they're being dismissed for various reasons. We have case 18118 that is being dismissed because it is out of the jurisdiction. May I have a motion?
So moved.
Second?
I'll second.
It has been moved.
I have a comment.
Okay, I'm sorry, I didn't ask for questions. Go ahead, Mr. Ward.
I'd like to ask, in the minutes, could it be please be listed something about what is the training officers receive about public media, and if the Bureau has a specific public media guidance document, just so that it's out in the public record, people understand what training they do receive or don't, and what is the, you know, the guidelines.
If I may respond, Mr. Waters, yes, you can make that notation, but also for your general information, the Pittsburgh Bureau of Police Policy Manual of General Orders is now online on the Bureau's site, and they're all there, which is a long time coming. There is some consternation in the rank and file about it being published, mostly because they see it as this is the policy, but there's internal operating standards that are different from what the policy tells you and met. It should have been online a long time ago. They are as of last Tuesday. So it's a tremendous resource, and we'll make the reference. We can note the policy number too.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. All in favor, aye?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it, the motion carries. And we have 1419. This one is being dismissed because of lack of cooperation from the client. May I have a motion, please?
Make the motion.
Second?
I'll second.
Questions? All in favor, aye?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it, the motion carries. And on the back of the paper, we have the ones that remain in suspension with no updates at this time. And I'll just read them into the record. 087-18, 109-18, 142-18, 145-18, 193-17, 202-18, 208-18, 221-18, 222-18, 248-17, 266-18, and 288-17. So we will wait to be provided with updates on those cases. So, at this time, are there any comments from our audience? So bizarre. Did he sign up?
I did not. But I was stimulated by the discussion that you just had. I would rush over and sign up if I could.
If you are wanting to give brief comments, I am going to allow you to do that.
Thank you. firstly say thank you so much for the discussion. I think very important to get some of those things onto the table. I tried to make a couple notes of things that came to my mind. And one that came to my mind was the word respect came up an awful lot, but the word respectable did not. I don't think. And so there's that side of it. People need to act in a respectable manner in order to be respected. And something that struck me as an example of not being very respectable and relating to police as a hate group was, it seems to me, that FOP supported Donald Trump. And Donald Trump supported a lot of hate groups. And that association, whether it's direct or indirect or whatever, is going to create some disrespect among certain groups. Because it's not a respectable behavior. In my opinion, it's not a respectable behavior. It has to be tolerated, but that's what it is. The idea of whether a situation is dangerous or not is a question of perceived danger. And the fostering of hate and hate groups can create a perceived danger from one ethnic or racial group that is greater than a perceived danger coming from another ethnic group or racial group. And that's something that I think has to be addressed, that idea of perceived danger and why, how it comes about that the police may feel more threatened by black people than they feel threatened by white people. This discrepancy between what happened at Squirrel Hill and what happened to Cornrows and so many other people is very stark. Some things don't go away very quickly. And the kind of disrespect that has been built up in certain communities and maybe being exacerbated now in certain communities isn't going to go away very quickly. It's going to take a lot of effort to do something about that. Who decides what's respectable? That would be my next question. What respect, not what's respect, but what's respectable? And that's where I think the community comes in with a very important input. The police need to listen to the community to understand what they think is respectable. It's not necessarily what's on the books. It's what people think. And that's just something that occurred to me during that discussion. I thank you all very much for that. And I hope that what you said to each other really gets some things moving. And I think that things are moving in the right direction. Congratulations on the UN police effort finally producing tremendous results.
Thank you very much. Okay, as a reminder, we have to submit our financial statements, so if you haven't done it, you need to do it. Okay. Can you tickle us the day before, if you don't mind,
yes,
if you
ma'am.
Don't have it?
Okay.
That's yes, ma'am. Okay. I would also like to thank Mr. Waters for the statement he made last month when I wasn't able to be here. I think it was a very, very deep, thought out and serious statement about the sentiment of what was going on at the time. And I'm glad it was entered into our records. So I thank you, Mr. Waters, for doing that. Okay, we have a public hearing scheduled for May 30th. Time?
5:30?
Here.
Okay.
Here? Okay. And of course, our next meeting is the 28th, 2 days before that public hearing, so we will remind you if we need to do that. So that is the schedule for us for the next month. Any comments from the board at all? As usual, I want to thank Mr. Ward for being with us and keeping us straight and giving us the advice we need at all times.
My pleasure, thank you.
Very good, and I want to thank the staff and our videographer for all that you do to record everything. We really appreciate your assistance, so thank you very much. All right, a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
I don't know if we'll have any opposition. I'm going to say second.
I'm sorry.
Thank you very much.